כבוד הרבנים, כבוד השלוחים, כבוד בעלי הבתים, תומכי לובביץ', די פרנזול, הנני העוני ממעש. I am humbly proud to be standing here at this podium on an occasion so unique and so auspicious, and before an audience so singular as yourselves. May I, with your permission, Rabbi Kotlovsky, first of all, to pay tribute to the caterers for tonight's fine gourmet dinner. Myself, being a kosher-eating Israeli diplomat, I seize every opportunity I can to partake of a solid kosher meal whilst I am on the road. For when one works for prime ministers who are not terribly fussy about kashrut, as was, say, the case of the late Yitzhak Rabin, one has to use some ingenuity to get by. I remember an occasion when President Gerald Ford hosted Prime Minister Rabin at an official state banquet in the White House. It was a sumptuous and extravagant affair. The 200-odd champagne-fueled guests were sitting at round tables, just as you do all tonight, in the state banqueting hall when, at an unseen signal, liveried, white-gloved butlers fanned out in faultless choreography, each bearing multiple feasts of sizzling roasted pheasant, roast potatoes, and decorative garnished beans. Soon everybody was chomping on their succulent fare, except me. I had pre-ordered a vegetarian kosher dish which, for some reason or other, did not turn up. Perhaps because my place card had been misspelled. Instead of Yehuda, it was engraved Yeduha Avner. To my left sat the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Brown, and to my right the television celebrity, Barbara Walters. Within minutes, the general caught sight of my still empty place setting and, craning his neck to read my name card, he called out, "Yeduha, you're not eating with us tonight." Whereupon, as if on cue, a butler stepped forward and placed before me a vegetarian extravaganza consisting of a base of lettuce as thick as a Tanakh, and this was topped by a mountain of diced fruit, and it was capped by a glob of cottage cheese, and all was crowned by a swish of whipped cream, so that the whole thingamajig must have stood about a foot high, and in contrast to everybody else's deep brown roasted pheasant, it glittered and sparkled like a firework. And everybody at my table greeted this fiesta of color with gasps of admiration, and Barbara Walters began to applaud. This, in turn, attracted the president's attention, and he whispered something into Yitzhak Rabin's ear, and Rabin whispered something back into the president's ear, whereupon the president, Zemasa Shehoya, whereupon the president, grinning from ear to ear, he rose to his feet and raised his glass high and called out to me, "Happy birthday, young fella!" With that, the entire banqueting hall rose to its feet and they all began to sing, "Happy birthday, dear Yeduha!" And I, as they sang, I slinked sleeplessly into my chair, absolutely mortified. After dinner, I asked Rabin why on earth he had told the president it was my birthday, And he shot back in deadly seriousness. I translate. What else should I have told him? The truth? And tomorrow there'll be a headline in the newspapers that you ate kosher and I didn't, and the religious parties will bolt the Knesset and the cabinet, and I'll have a government crisis on my hands. Ani meshuga, am I crazy? Morai v'rabotai. Tonight, I want to speak about an epic. It is an epic called Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson Zichrono Livracha de Lubavitcher Rebbe. And I've chosen as my theme his moral vision as statesman and diplomat. It is an epic about the Jewish people's most extraordinary visionary in living memory, an immortal whose leadership sparked a torch of Jewish renewal across all continents, a man whose presence was so inspiringly strong it is sustained to this day in the devoted work of yourselves, you the Shaluchim, the thousands of his disciples who dedicate your lives to the building of fortresses of Judaism, often in the most remote corners of our earth. Wherever Jews are, there we find you, the Shaluchim of the Lubavitcher Rebbe. Et chata'ai ani maskir hayom, though I am not a card-carrying member of Lubavitch, I had the privilege to have been a sort of unofficial liaison between Rabbi Schneerson and the various Israeli prime ministers whom I served. And it is assuredly an interesting commentary on our political leadership that they sought in one degree or another to maintain some sort of contact with this extraordinary luminary who lived under the chestnut and maple trees of Brooklyn rather than under the poplars and pines of Yerushalayim, to which mysteriously he never journeyed. I never asked him why. I never asked him why, because being a mere diplomatic practitioner, I was intellectually humble enough to realize that he dwelt on an entirely different plane, a profoundly mystical plane, one to which I could never aspire. The Lubavitcher Rebbe was a theologian, not a political Zionist. But if Zionism is an unconditional, passionate devotion to Eretz Israel and to its security and welfare in the spirit of Etechezena Enenu B'Shuvcha L'Tzion Berachamim, then Rabbi Menachem Mendel Schneerson was a fanatical Zionist.